Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Ham Nation is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by DX Engineering. DX Engineering offers practically everything you need to outfit your shack, plus the fastest shipping in the industry. In-stock items ship the same day, Monday through Friday, until 10 p.m. Eastern. For more information, visit dxengineering.com/hamnation. And by Warby Parker Eyewear. Get boutique-quality, classically crafted eyewear, including sunglasses, at revolutionary prices. For a free home try-on of 5 stylish frames of your choice, plus free 3-day shipping, go to warbyparker.com/hamnation. And by ICOM. For more information, visit icomamerica.com/hamnation.
This is Ham Nation, show number 200, June 10th, 2015. We have Joe Walsh as our guest. Well, good evening, everybody. We're so happy you're here. This is a very special night for many reasons. The first reason, this is the 200th Ham Nation show that we have put together. And of course, it went a long way. Way out there from what I thought it would be. And when Leo invited us to have a little session on ham radio, the first guy that I thought of would be my good friend Joe, because he's like a great ham radio operator. And he's here again. Joe Walsh, WB6ACU. Hello, and thanks for joining us tonight.
It's great to be here. Hi, everybody. I'm glad to be on. I never dreamed it would go 200 shows. You know, but that's great. So I'm here to say hi and check in and add my two cents to the commentary.
Yes. Well, I tell you that after you and I did that first one, I figured, well, let's keep going. So the other guy I called was probably the best guy to do this show is Gordon West. Gordo, the ultimate teacher of ham radio. How are you?
Hey, happy 200. Joe, thanks for joining us. Bob, thanks for dreaming this whole thing up with Leo Laporte. And what a ride it's been. And I'm just delighted to be here and to say hi to everybody. And we'll see everybody live this Thursday, Friday, and Saturday in Irving, Texas at HamCom. So if you're from Texas, come on by and say hi. Back to you, Bob.
Okay. Joe and I were there one year, the year they were opening America Center, if you remember that, Joe. You guys were just happened to be playing in town that weekend, and we got to go to HamCom, didn't we?
Yeah, we sure did. We sure did. Yeah. Boy, I'd like to go again. That's one of the great ones.
It was, and we had fun. Well, Joe, we also brought Valerie on with us. I think you met her the first night she was on, that particular night I was out on tour. Valerie, thanks for being here tonight. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm doing great. And thanks for having me on the show. And I just want to say thanks to you and Gordo and Joe for letting me be a part of this show. And everybody, Leo Laporte and everybody at the Twit Studios. My life has changed so much since I've been on this show. And it's all because of Ham Nation and Twit TV. So thank you so much for bringing me in here, making me part of the family.
Well, I understand that you did a little video, a kind of a compilation of what's been going on. So why don't you go ahead, take it back and introduce that and see what's going on, okay?
Let me just quick preface this. I was originally going to bake a raspberry pie when carved 200 into it. I was on my way to the grocery store. On my way home from work last night, when the idea popped in my head to show a snippet of all 199 episodes. So needless to say, I've been working on that all night long last night so I could get it in the can for today. So this is a 5-minute video, and it shows a snippet from every single Ham Nation episode. If you want to go ahead and show that, Brian.
Bye.
Well, I hope I didn't miss anybody. I think I got everybody in there. I had to fly by fast, but that's my gift to you guys. Thank you so much.
That was wonderful. And I bet that took you a lot of time to do it. So you can bake the raspberry pie for the 300.
Yeah, maybe I'll do that. Or Dayton.
That was great. And this one of those things that we don't think about it. We do them every week. And Joe, I really personally thank you. And I know lots of other people thank you for doing the theme song that plays here every week at the beginning. And we appreciate you doing that. That was a lot of work, wasn't it?
Well, yeah, and it was fun work. I haven't heard it in a long time, and I haven't heard the whole thing in a long time. I don't know if anybody's heard the whole thing top to bottom. But Valerie, that was a labor of love, and thanks so much. Thank you so much. Just wonderful. I had a keyboard that was touch sensitive. In other words, it was a synthesizer, but the keyboard could sense how hard you were pushing on the key. And that was triggering the voices, whether they went bup, bup, or bow, bow, or do, 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 was all how hard you hit the key. And I had totally forgot about that. But that's all the voices you heard singing the scat singing. And it's pretty good picking on there. You know, here pretty on good. The list. Les
yeah,
Paul's
you should go pro.
Birthday today. So happy birthday to Les Paul, and and back to you, Bob.
Well, you know that yesterday was Les Paul's 100th birthday, Joe. Did you know that? I did. Sarah reminded me at dinner tonight. He was 100 years old. He would have been 100 years old yesterday. That's pretty cool, isn't it?
Yep, it sure is. I knew Les really well. I went to his house a couple times and saw his studio and all these amazing things that he soldered together. And some of them became inventions, and some of them are just piles of stuff he soldered together. But he was a mad scientist, besides being a brilliant guitar player.
He would have been a good ham. I mentioned that a couple of times we were together, and he said, well, I thought about it, and I got into that CB thing, and I didn't like what I was hearing, so I didn't go any further. But he would have made a good ham, don't you think?
Oh, yeah. 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 He would have been great on 80 meters late at night. He probably could have talked for a couple hours about anything he wanted to talk about and no more than you did.
That's right. Oh, that's great. Well, we had to send Gordo on his merry way. He's teaching a class tonight, so he took off. But look who's in his place. It's Don Wilbanks. Hi, Don. How are you?
Hey, everybody. Hey, Joe. Good to see you. I've got a couple of guitars sitting back there, but unlike you, I'm more of an owner than a player. And every time I hear you play, and another one of my favorite guitarists, you may know this guy, Pat Travers. Anytime I hear you or him play, I get the urge on one side of my brain to practice really, really hard until my fingers bleed. And then the other side of my brain makes me just want to go out in the yard and set them on fire. So I'm conflicted about the whole guitar thing. But anyway, thank you for everything that you've done for Ham Nation. And you know, I've been in radio a long time, and I've played, like you or like Valerie, I've played a lot of your songs on the radio. So thank you for many years of inspiration and joy. So just from my heart to yours, thank you, sir.
Well, great, Don. Thank you very much. And if it's any compensation, I have guitar players that I listen to, and it makes me want to just like throw my guitar in the pool and do something else. So you're not alone. No matter what part of the totem pole you're on, there's somebody higher than you, believe me.
Exactly. Yeah. And you know, it's all about playing for how it makes you feel inside. And if everybody else likes it and you can make a living out of it, then so much the better. And you've certainly done that. Well, we've got a great 200th show tonight, and I'm so happy that everyone is here. Valerie and George, and he's coming up a little bit later with Smoke and Solder. In fact, I believe he's going to be talking about Ballins, and I got something in the mail today that I want to show you. It is the final piece of the puzzle from my lightning strike. Now, you remember this image here, I'm sure. That is what's left of my Ballin.
Show that to Joe and tell him the story.
Yeah, Joe, I got hit by lightning. This is the Ballin for my 80-meter off-center fed dipole. It came down the antenna, went into a Kenwood TS-2000, which was attached to a computer by way of a USB cable. It fried that. It fried the computer. It fried two Xboxes. It fried two TVs. It fried the printer. About $6,000 worth of stuff. This was on the 15th. And so, anyway, I've gotten all that replaced, and I've upgraded a little bit. I now am the proud owner of thanks to a lot of help from a good friend, Mr. Novak. I have an ICOM IC7600 and an ID5100. So, Ray, thank you for the help and assistance in getting my shack back together. I do appreciate that. But here's the new piece that came in from Emmett at Radio Waves today. This is what that Ballin looked like originally. Now, there is a picture of the inside. Brian, if you'll bring that up, I'll show you what's inside this. You see the top section of that Ballin, it's gone. Now, if we go back to the one that's destroyed, you can see just how much is left. Lightning did that. That Ballin did not fail on its own. Lightning did that. And I just think that the fact that the bottom half of it is still, well, with us today, because I haven't found a single atom from anything above the top of this outside. So it's just amazing. And here's the goofy part. Show you how well he makes these things. If you come back to me, that's the part where the antenna leg's attached to. Do you know that is still hanging in the air, supporting the two legs of that antenna? Can you believe that? That part survived. It's still up in the tree, holding the antenna up. So anyway, I'm well on my way to getting things back together. So yeah, it's great. It's great. I wanted to talk a little bit about Newsline. Newsline is on its way back through Skeeter Nash and myself. We're going to do our best to get production back up of Newsline. If not this week, hopefully next. And I have some good news about Bill as well. You know, he was taken out of ICU a few days ago into a slightly lower level of care, still pretty critical. Well, the good news I got today is that he is going to be moved soon to another facility, a respiratory support hospital, which again is a little slightly lower level of care, but he's still in pretty bad shape. He has some broken vertebrae in his back, and so he's confined to the bed, obviously, which makes typing really, really hard. But I talked to him on the phone, and he sounds weak, but Bill is Bill, and you know, the old saying, you can't kill bad grass. Well, that's kind of what we're hoping. We're hoping Bill is really, really, really bad grass, because we want to have him around for a long time. So hopefully Newsline and the Ham Nation videos will return shortly. We do, however, have Tamitha Scove with us tonight. Now, there's a little bit of audio with difficulties here. She lost her computer as well, and she's almost got it back to 100%, but not quite. So you may hear a little wonky audio in here, but it shouldn't be enough to distract you too much. So here's a few minutes of Dr. Tamitha Scove, and then we'll come back and talk about DX Engineering.
Hi, I'm Tamitha Scove with your solar storm forecast for the week of June 10th. The sun's activity has really picked up this week. We've had multiple regions rotating around from the east limb. None of them have brought us any M flares, but we do have a new M flare contender, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Meanwhile, we've been getting some storming from this coronal hole. Some fast wind has hit us, and it's still causing some issues for us. We have another coronal hole that'll be sending us some new fast wind in a couple days. We also have a couple solar storms that have been launched from this region. One of them is Earth-directed. And if you look right here, right around the backside, we are now seeing the part of a new M-flare contender, and we should get a better look at it in the next couple days. Switching to our M-flare threat meter, you can see we've actually been below the seafloor for quite some time, but activity is beginning to pick up. We've actually reached almost at the M-flare threat level over the past couple days, and with this new region rotating around, I bet you this activity will continue. Switching to your solar storm conditions, you can see we've actually enjoyed an extended period of quiet until about June 8th, when we got hit by a transient disturbance ahead of some fast solar wind, and it brought us a brief but moderate geomagnetic storm. And that caused some gorgeous aurora over Canada and United States, as well as Tasmania and New Zealand. And we're still feeling the effects of that high-speed stream. The amateur radio bands are still kind of recovering. So what else does the sun have in store for us this week? Well, this is ENLIL. It's our prediction model. This is NASA's version of the model. And you can see there's been a solar storm that's been launched that's kind of Earth-directed. It looks like it's going to go east of us, but it might possibly graze us on the 12th. If we flip up to the impact footprint, you can see here's Earth here, and it is just barely grazing us. So we could see some effects starting around the 12th to the 13th. Switching to your solar storm conditions and aurora possibilities over the coming week, we are still feeling the effects of that high-speed stream. So NOAA's giving us a chance for some minor storming at high latitudes, not so much at mid-latitudes, but when the 12th hits, that grazing solar storm passage comes, we do have a chance for some storming at high latitudes, maybe even some major storming. At mid-latitudes, don't expect nearly so much, but it's still a good chance for aurora possibilities. And then as we push into the end of the week, we might start feeling some effects from the new fast wind that's coming from that second coronal hole that we saw, and that could continue the storming in through the weekend. So we do have some good chance for aurora, but most likely amateur radio bands might be a little bit messed up this week. So this week looks like it's going to be a buzz of activity. We are still feeling the lingering effects from the high-speed stream. On the 12th and the 13th, we are expecting a glancing blow from that Earth-directed solar storm. And then right after that, we're going to start feeling the effects of yet another high-speed stream. So pretty much all week, we've got something happening. And this could bring us some more aurora, as well as disruptions on the amateur radio bands and possibly even GPS, maybe at high latitudes, pretty much for the entire week. Now, on top of that, we have that new M-flare contender that hasn't even rotated into view yet. It's given us a couple what we call occulted high C-class flares, which means that when it finally comes into real view, we might actually see something that pops up above that M-flare threat level. And that could bring us more disruptions for you amateur radio and you GPS users. So we'll be watching that very closely. I'm Tamitha Scove. Thank you for watching.
Well, thank you for being here, Dr. T. And you'll see her Twitter address there on the bottom of the screen, at Tamitha Scove. You can get up-to-the-minute commentary from her, up-to-the-second commentary from her on Twitter. You definitely need to follow her Twitter account and go to spaceweather.tv as well. And if you go to the ICOM America YouTube channel, you can see her presentation at Dayton 2015 at the Antenna Forum. And she had a great time. She's not a ham yet, but we fixed her up with books from a certain dude named Gordon. So we hope to get her licensed soon. Yes?
Hey, we got to really work on her a little more, cuz we got to have her but in this fraternity, that for sure. Yeah. Joe, you're probably going to be out on tour. You're going to miss all this sunspot activity, right?
Yeah, I probably will. I got to travel this weekend, and I'm actually home for 2 weeks, and then I go out for another round of Eagle shows. But you know what? I've been tuning around. So I've been home for 2 days, and bands are dead. And I thought my rig was no good, or my antenna blew up or something. But that explains it.
Do you have any lightning?
Now you know.
No, but I took a... No, we don't have lightning out here, but I took a direct hit. I lived in Colorado, and I know what you mean. Yeah. I know what you mean. It's really nice that I wasn't on the air.
Yeah.
It was nice that
we weren't home. My 15-year-old son, however, was. And he said, Daddy, that was loud.
Yeah, you know what? There's no thunder either. It's just a huge crack.
Yeah.
And blinding flash. Because, you know, it's right on top of you. It's not far away. So there's no thunder. You know, there's nothing like it. There's nothing like it.
Well, let's hope we don't get any bad weather for field day.
I want to know more about what's behind you. We've got a couple of things going on, so we'll fire up your rig. But we got a couple of things to talk about first. One of them I got in the mail the other day. It's my big bar of chocolate for the 200th. I hope you got yours, Don. If not, I'll have to share it with you. I also got my new calendar or my new catalog. So you can talk more about this great company called DX Engineering, but I had to show my chocolate. So we're going to come back to what that is behind him. I think it's a Hallicrafters, Don.
Yeah, I don't have the chocolate yet, or my wife is a chocolate fiend, so I may not see it. It may have gotten here, and I just don't know about it. But anyway, let's hope we don't have any lightning for field day. And strangest thing I saw at field day once was an extra class ham on top of an aluminum ladder being held by another extra class ham, and both the feet of the extra class ham and the feet of the ladder were in about 6 inches of water, and they were stringing a wire antenna in the air, and there was lightning popping all over the place. But hey, that's field day. It's what you do. I've also seen flying relish and pickles, but that's a story for another day we've covered before. But anyway, as we're saying, it's almost time for field day, and if you've got the new DX Engineering Spring Summer 2015 catalog, then you already know that is your go-to place for everything field day. Here's just a taste of what you can find in there to make field day even better than ever. There's more to field day than just radios and antennas. They have things you may not think about, like, well, folding chairs, canopies, umbrellas, because a lot of people stay out there the whole 24. I used to do that. Keeps you comfortable all day and all night. You're on your own with the mosquitoes. DX Engineering apparel, like the lightweight, breathable polo shirts. You've seen us wear those here. They're perfect if it's a scorcher. And let me tell you something. They look really, really sharp for when the public comes out. And that's what it's all about, is putting your best foot and face forward when the general public comes out and wants to know, what in the world are y'all doing out here? And when it's time to set up, you can count on DX Engineering for the all-important guy rope and the coaxial cable as well. The guy rope is from Mastrant, and that is the best stuff. You can use it to hang antennas, guy canopies, and tie your tables down in a high wind. And the DX Engineering coax is priced so low, you can bulk up and outfit a new portable setup without having to rip apart your shack for old cables. Nothing worse than that. And they also offer, you've done that, haven't you? Take half your house apart to take it out to the park. Yeah. And then you never get it all back together. It just doesn't happen. They also offer bulk cable spools. You can order pre-made cable assemblies as well if you don't want to roll your own. And you got to have power, too. And so DX Engineering carries rock-solid, reliable Generac and AI-powered generators. There are several generator options. You can get the right one for your exact specifications. They're also CARB compliant, so you're not going to run afoul of any local regulations and stink up the place with the exhaust. You can also shop the vast DX Engineering selection of DC power accessories to build a clean, safe DC power distribution system. I want you to go to dxengineering.com. You can see even more products to make your field day enjoyable. If you haven't got your new 2015 DX Engineering Field Day catalog, it's probably on the way. But if it's not, go ahead and sign up and get it for free at dxengineering.com. The ARRL VHF contest is this weekend. So if you need last-minute VHF gear, get your order in now because you know about that shipping. I'll tell you a bit more about that. And if you're not contesting this weekend, the propagation conditions may be a little iffy, but depending on what it was that Dr. Scove was telling us, but the 2- and 6-meter band should be okay. But the window was closing. DX Engineering has a ton of high-quality VHF base station antennas in stock and ready to ship tonight. Check out the Beam and Yagi antennas from Cushcraft, JK, M-Squared. The M-Squared 2- and 6-meter 1,200-watt amplifiers offer excellent VHF performance. And if you get hungry for lunch, you can just take that a couple of hot dogs, stick on the end of that Yagi, and fire up that 1,200-watt, and you've got a hot dog. DX Engineering ships faster than anyone else in the industry. If you want to cook a pickle, you talk to Gordon about that. Get your order in by 10 p.m. Eastern. If it's in stock, it will be on a truck headed your way tonight. Proven products, expert advice. DX Engineering helps you shrink the globe. Grab your catalog or shop online 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at dxengineering.com/hamnation. DX Engineering, thank you so much for your support of Ham Nation. We literally could not do it without friends like you. And we also couldn't do it without friends like George Thomas, W5JDX. He's coming up with smoke and solder. You're going to be talking about these, aren't you, George? You're talking about balans and stuff, I think.
Actually, I am, Don, but I'm going to talk about this one right here.
Okay.
It's it's one I just built, but I think Bob was asking Joe about that Hallicrafters behind him there. And before we talk about this balan, I want to know a little bit more about that.
This is a HT32. Hollycrafters. Beautiful, beautiful. This is an HC32B. Beautiful sideband transmitter. Probably the flagship of Hollycrafter sideband efforts. And I do have the matching receiver here. I'll move this over. That is an SX115.
Wow.
It's the matching receiver and the TO Keyer, which is a famous Keyer, and Autronics Key. That's a favorite of a lot of the high-speed DX contesters. Autronics was a great key company. And so that's what I got. That's what I got hooked up. And it's a pleasure. It's just a pleasure to operate. You know, it takes a while to get on frequency. We didn't used to get exactly on the frequency in the old days. If you got close, you know, that was good enough. So, you know, I get yelled at, hey, you're off frequency, but I don't care. It's really fun to operate these old rigs, and just nothing like it to actually take the time to tune it up and get on frequency, get the transmitter on with the receiver, same place, and all of that. So that's what I got sitting here, and I hope that met your expectations.
Well, it surpassed them. That really looks like it just came off the factory line there. It's so clean looking. You don't have your AM broadcast transmitter hooked back up yet, do you?
No, I don't. We are in a house that we're going to live in for a year. Our other house really needed to be worked on because it was built about 1940. So they're putting that together, and as soon as that's up, I'm going to put a real antenna up and get back on AM. 3870 here on the West Coast is headquarters for the AM, and there's a great community from Alaska all the way to San Diego and out into the Midwest if the conditions are right. But I'm not currently on AM. That takes a lot of... A lot of work also and a lot of juice, and I'm on a second floor here, so carrying it up the stairs, you know, 1,000 pounds is more than I can do by myself.
Oh, I understand that. Well, what you have to do is take all the iron out of it, take the transformers out, then you can just haul it up on your back.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Well, it was good to talk with you again, Joe. You know, last time you were on the show here, I asked you which type of solder, leaded or unleaded, and you said whatever you got. So,
yeah, pretty much yep. Whatever's lying around, you know, we'll use, won't we?
Anything that'll melt, yep. Well, Don was asking about this Ballon right here, and this is a high-power one here that I constructed in the past week. So let's take a look at that video real quick.
This week on Smoke and Solder, we're going to continue talking about Ballons, but this time we're actually going to build one. This is going to be a 1-to-1 Ballon, and I'll use it to connect my 50-ohm antenna to my 50-ohm transmission line. Let's take a look at the materials that we'll need. We're going to need some tape that's heat resistant, and this glass cloth tape is a good choice. This stuff is kind of like fiber. It's very sticky. You can get this to wrap your toroids and wires with from Amidon Corporation. The price right now is $6.50 a roll, or you could use something like this Kapton tape here. You can find that on eBay for $2.99 right now. It's 10 millimeters wide and 33 millimeters long. You could also use something like this plumber's Teflon tape. This stuff is available at your hardware store. It's not very expensive. It'll work good for wrapping the Ballon with. I'm not so sure about wrapping the wires and holding them together, though. Of course, we're going to need some kind of wire to use as the transmission line that wraps around the Ballon. We're going to use 14-gauge, 200-degree Celsius magnet wire, and you can find this stuff on eBay from a supplier like Temco. You can get a 20-foot spool for about $7, or a 40-foot spool for around $9. We're going to need a toroid, and we're going to use a ferrite 31-mix 2.4-inch toroid, part number 26318-03802. And you can find these from commercial suppliers like Krieger, Mauser, or Newark. Krieger's price is presently $6.93. Now, this one has been partially taped. We're going to continue taping it because it's got to be completely covered. This is conductive, and we don't want it shorting out with the wires. We're also going to need some way to house the balun, and I'm going to use this weatherproof electrical box that I picked up at my local Lowe's. This is a Carlin brand. It's not very expensive. It's really a little bigger than we need to hold this size of balun, but, you know, I looked around at the price of buying PVC pipe and end caps and all, and since I'm only building a single one here, this was the most economical solution. Plus, it's easy to open up later if I need to get in and do some repair work, and it's waterproof. We'll need a little more hardware to go with the box, so I bought these eye hooks from Lowe's as well. They're stainless steel, and that's what we need for a project like this. We don't want to put something out there that's going to rust and not stand up in the weather. I'm also going to use some 1024 1-inch long bolts. These will be used to feed through so that we can connect the wires of our antenna to. And I bought some wing nuts to put on there, so it'll make it kind of easy to attach our wires from the antenna. We'll need a way to attach our coax to the balun, so for that we're going to use an SO239. This will just mount here to the outside of the cabinet. We'll need to seal around it to keep moisture out. And we'll need some screws for that, so I've got some number 632 half-inch stainless steel screws once again here because we don't want this rusting. And naturally, I've got the lock washers and nuts to go with that. I want to thank Joe Zaleski, KC8LC, for doing the research and getting all the materials together that we're going to be using here. One thing that he wrote out here I was not aware of is there's a chart. Apparently, balluns are more frequency sensitive than I had suspected. If we're going to do a 1.8 to 5 megahertz, we'll want 16 turns of bifiller windings on the number 31 core. For 3.5 to 10 megahertz, we'll want 14 bifiller turns. That's what I'm going to use. Or for 10 to 30 megahertz, we'll want 12 bifiller turns. And you calculate this by taking roughly the number of turns that you're going to need, multiplying that by 2.7 inches, plus about 4 inches for the end connection. So you should have about 37 inches for 14 turns. And that's what we've got here. I've measured it out. Joe had started actually wrapping these to prepare them. We still got to do some on the end here. But really, before you get into putting the tape on here to wrap these together, what you should do is scrape back about 1 inch of the insulation on all four ends of the wires here and tin them. So that's what we'll do now. In order to make this go as quick as it can so that I won't overheat the wire, I'll put a little flux here on it. You'll notice I'm applying the solder to the wire and not directly to the tip of the iron. It's time to move on and prepare the toroid. It's a good idea to write the mix on the toroid in case you ever have to replace it and you want to know what it was. This is a number 31, of course. And Joe had already partially wrapped this one with tape. We're going to finish off the job, though. Now, it looks to me like Joe cut this tape into strips that were half as wide, and that'll probably make it a little easier when we go to wrap it around the toroid, so I think I'm going to do that too. We want our two wires to be perfectly parallel with each other. No twist in them. And every inch and a half, we're going to wrap it with a little piece of the glass tape. I've cut this into quarter-inch strips now. And now I'm going to mark the ends of one of the wires, and that'll be the one that goes to the center pin of the coax connector. We want to keep these wires as straight and flat as possible. We're going to wind them around the toroid here, and we'll leave about an inch and a half exposed out the side. We'll need 14 turns like this. Each time you go through the core, should be one turn. And we don't want to twist the wires as we wrap it. We want to keep them flat and closely spaced. Our end game is to keep the ends of the wire as far apart as possible. And this stuff is a little stiff, so it's going to take a little patience. I'm going to tie wrap this end here, and then I'll continue on with the rest of it. There we go. 14 turns, as tight as I can get them. Evenly spaced, and we're relatively as far apart as we can get on the two ends there. Our next step will be to prepare the box. Marked all my holes, and we're ready to drill. We'll put the eye hook in the top. We'll put the SO239 in the bottom. And on each side, we're going to put a screw terminal to connect our antenna. First, I'll drill my pilot holes, and then we'll work up to the actual size. Like that size right there, that means that it's kind of tight, so I'll actually have some threads here in the plastic. That's a good tight fit there, so we won't have to worry too much about water leaking around it. Plus, since I've only got one nut that actually fits this eye hook, this will just give me some extra tension to keep it from unscrewing. For the 1024 bolts, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to go a little bit tight with it. Well, here it is all assembled. I didn't have time to show the complete assembly here. Just this time around, we showed you mostly winding the toroid here. And we'll be covering more of this in the future because I'm going to build a 4-to-1 ballon. But for this particular one, I ended up with the SO239 mounted from the bottom. I decided that once I had screwed a PL259 connector on here, there just wasn't enough room left for me to wrap it good with insulating tape. So I put it on the outside rather than mount it from the inside. I would have rather had it on the inside, but it just didn't look like it was going to work out. I've got some washers here. I've made that super tight, and hopefully that will hold it. If it gets hot or that plastic melts, then we're going to have a bad connection there. That's why I really wanted the connector mounted with the flange on the inside. Of course, I've got the other side soldered here to the center pin. Up here on the antenna end, you can see I've put the screws through from the inside. I've got a lock washer under there, and the crimp lug is up under that. I got that super tight as well, and a nut here on the outside that's super tight to hold that together. And then another lock washer, and I got wing nuts out on the end. As long as these crimp terminals here stay tight, we're in good shape. Let's do some testing now with the MFJ-259C antenna analyzer. I've got an old terminator here from an old coax network connection. It's 50 ohms. I've got it stuck in a T and just a wire kind of run around the outside here and crammed up in there. So I've got the 50 ohm terminator just as close as I can to the ballon itself. Here we're looking at around 2 megahertz, and we can see it's showing 51, 52 ohms, a reactance of 0, a SWR of 1.0. We increase the frequency here. We see it staying pretty steady, 52 ohms, but the reactance and the SWR are not changing. Let's go on up to the next range here. I'm going to be using this on my 80-meter loop, so that's primarily where I'm interested. So 4.6 megahertz. 53 ohms, reactance of 0. As we increase it, it comes up another ohm or so there. We can go up all the way to 10 megahertz, which is what this ballon was rated for, and we just start seeing some reactance in. 54 ohms, so it's fairly flat across those bands. Mike could do a little better with some touch-up on it. I'm really not sure as to what's typical for a ballon like this, but I think this one's going to do fine. So I'll put the cover on it, and I'm going to put it on my loop as soon as I get a chance. So there you go, a heavy-duty, legal-limit, 1-to-1 ballon. And that was a lot of fun to build. I don't know if it's going to make out any better in the lightning, though, Don. If you got lightning, you just got a problem. Well, you know, last week I asked a question, what does the term ballon mean? And we had a winner. That was Gail KB0RZD. And Gail said balanced to unbalanced. And that's correct. So congratulations, Gail. We're going to send you this copy of Morse code breaking the barrier
the book from Dave Finley, N1IRZ, courtesy of MFJ. For next week, we've got a nice prize. It's going to be the Howell Pro Set 3. No, not this pair right here. This is my pair, but I've got some just like them in the box back here. If you'd like to win those, answer this for me. To connect a 200-ohm balanced antenna to a 50-ohm transmission line, what ratio of balun would you need? And if you think you know the answer to that, send your answer to me, hamnationcontest@gmail.com, and you could win. So we got a set of these. Somebody's going to win them. Might as well be you. Send your answer to me. Well, I think we need to get Don in here now and talk about a new sponsor we've got. Don, who are we going to talk about today?
We're going to yak about this little company called Warby Parker. And they do glasses. They do cool glasses. You want to start out, and then you talk about the prescription stuff, and I'll come back and talk about what I got on my melon here. How's that sound?
That sounds good, Don. Well, I'm just going to kind of make it up because this is the home trial kit right here, and they don't have my prescription in them, so I can't really read the copy very well. But what you do is you go to warbyparker.com, and you go on and you choose five different pair that you like and give them your name and address. They're going to send them to you in the mail, and then once you've got them, you can go through all five pairs. Check them out and see just which ones you like best. Or you can do like me and you can ask your wife which one works best. And that's kind of what I did, but I've got a variety of them here. Also, of course, they have sunglasses like you've got there, but you can even get, say, straight prescription glasses, but also they've got the great progressive lenses. And theirs are a little bit different. They're digitally produced so that you've got a little wider field of vision for progressive lenses. Great glasses. Give them a try. Don, tell us a little more about them.
Yeah, they're great. It's a great company. They were selected the number one most innovative company in 2015 by Fast Company. High-quality, stylish prescription glasses and sunglasses. Now, they start at just $95, the glasses do. That includes your prescription. And they go off from there. Progressive lenses, around $295. But go to warbyparker.com and /hamnation and check it all out. The shades that I'm wearing now, I picked out five. And these that I have on my face right now, they kind of spoke to me. And the cool thing about the try-on thing is they send you five pairs. Now, I really liked the way these looked originally, but in the car, I noticed that they're a little small for my face because I got a lot of sun going through. And I don't wear prescription lenses anymore because I had LASIK surgery on my eyes. And so because of that, my eyes are really, really sensitive to the sun. So I picked out five. So these were the first pair, and I really like these. If they were a little bit bigger, I probably would take them home. Now, of course, you know, they have classic. Here's the classic aviators, you know? Kind of dig these. Kind of like the look of them. Kind of like the, boy, you were speeding. So, you know, maybe that might be good, you know, for the Trans Am. I'm kind of stuck on Wayfarers. And so I picked out variations of a theme for classic Wayfarers. Now, these are cool, but I didn't like the way that they fit my face. And again, this is the cool thing about having five pair to try on. And then here's another pair that, you know, they were neat. It just didn't quite feel. So anyway, they sent me the perfect pair of sunglasses. And that's these right here. The shape of the temple here goes right over my ear. And it fit. I've been wearing these for the last two or three days in the car. And they're comfortable. They don't slip. They've got the perfect coverage. And I believe Blind Mississippi Hambone likes them too. So this may be some, this may be some guitar picking sunglasses right here. What do you think? But anyway, you want to go to warbyparker.com/hamnation. Choose your five pairs of glasses. They will send them to you in the box. You try them on and simply choose the frames you want. You send the try home back and tell them the one you want. And bang, boom, they got it for you. Warbyparker.com. You go to that website. They also have They have actual stores, and there's one in New Orleans on Royal Street. I'm going to have to go check that out because they have a cool thing. They have a professional photographer on staff in there, so you can go in there and get your portrait shot professionally with you and your new glasses. It's pretty slick. Right. WarbyParker.com/HamNation, brand new sponsor. First day on, and man, we hope to have a whole lot more days with Warby Parker. WarbyParker.com/HamNation. Warby Parker, thank you so much for your support of Ham Nation. What, Heil, they didn't have any in purple?
Well, no, mine are blue with white, but that's okay.
All right. You got to get you a nice hat now. Get you a
yeah,
nice hat.
Close now. Enough for now. Well, I would just, and going along the show with my iced tea, did you know it was National Iced Tea Day today? I don't know if anybody knew that or not, but anyway.
Yeah.
Joe, I want to talk to you a little bit so you and I can help a lot of people about this thing called AM. You know, it's really kind of sad because some of the new guys, they weren't around when you and I started way back in their century there with AM. And 3870 to 3890 was a gentleman's agreement since we couldn't get the FCC or the ARRL to listen. And we just all got together. This happened way back in the 50s. When I first started. And how is it holding up on the West Coast, Joe? Is everybody respecting that that AM window from 3870 to 3890?
Yeah, Bob, I would say AM is alive and well on the West Coast. There was initially some sideband guys who, you know, claimed it was their frequency, they were there first. But gradually, the AM community built up to, usually more than 40 hams check in on the various nets, sometimes up to 60 guys on AM. And so, you know, good things take time, and gradually it's just kind of where the AMers go. So now the sideband guys just talk about how crazy we are.
Right.
not on our frequency. They have a
well, one of the good. One of the good things that. So when you and I visited the W1AW some years ago, thought it'd be a good idea, and now there's an AM station at W1AW. Would we put a NC300 and a Viking 1 or 2 up there, right?
Yeah, Viking 1, I think. I'm pretty sure. Mm-hmm. Or was it a
yeah.
Valiant? Might have been a Valiant.
Been a Valiant. I forgot. The last time. Sitting on the actual desk of Hiram Percy, Maxim, they have his grandson gave the W1AW his desk, and that's where the gear is sitting. So when you go to W1AW, you can go in there and work AM. I just thought that was great, Joe. It was a great idea.
Yeah. And AM is just a wonderful thing. It's not rapid fire. You kind of, it's a rag chewing type of mode. And you talk technical stuff, you talk basically analog electronics, and AM's a wonderful old mode that predated sideband. AM came first for years and years and years, and all this stuff is obsolete now, but it works great. It just has tubes in it, and it's too heavy to lift. But that's a lot of fun. That's a lot of fun. That's a lot of fun with it. And anybody, you know, anybody with any interest in the old tube radios, check out AM or contact an AMer because they're great, great Elmers.
That's right, and that's what we need more of are some Elmers. And we, you know, Joe, that since you and I did that first program, we have emails to prove this over the 200 shows, There's been over 1,000 people get their license because of Ham Nation. And we're so excited that these people have their license, but we hear it time and time again, they get a little afraid because they don't have the Elmers like you and I had. And I have some pictures here. I want to run down, I think Brian's got them. I got a really cool set. Check this out, Joe. I'm sure you've seen this in Kent, Ohio. Yeah. Is a mural. And isn't that cool? Is there any history you want to tell about that?
Well, in the 70s, in Kent, Ohio, there was a little music community and some clubs all on a street called Water Street. And a whole bunch of people came out of there. Chrissy Hines from the Pretenders was from there, a whole bunch of us. And Water Street is kind of famous for some great bands that came out of it. It's a college town. And so to commemorate Water Street and how important it was for musicians having a good place to play, they put a mural up of me, and I'm grateful. I'm grateful. One other thing I want to show you, Bob. Have a look at this. I'll see if you can see it. That's me in 1961. I was 12 years old. My novice call was WV2KAC, and that's a Heathkit DX20 that I built. And a BC-348 surplus receiver.
Yes.
That's yes. Me when I was 12 years old, and that's my station. WV2, Willie Victor 2 KAC. I was a novice, and I just found that. So I'm really proud of it.
Well, I have a picture here coming up with Jim. Jim and I... I want you to tell the story about Jim, about how you got into ham radio and how Jim helped you. And he has the log. He brought his log of your first contact. You worked him, of course. And then I brought that log to you. So tell us a little story about how you got into ham radio and what significance Jim had on your life.
Okay, well, in about 1959, my family relocated from Ohio to New York City. And I had been a country boy, grew up in Ohio. We had all kinds of fields to play in and a lot of room and vacant lots and like that. But I wound up in New York City in a third floor apartment with my parents, and I didn't know anybody because it was summer and I didn't have any friends till school started. But that summer I was all by myself, and it was really, really, really a shock to go from Ohio and being part of a whole community of kids just to being a total loner. And so I noticed that there was this thing up on the roof of the apartment building that went around on Saturday mornings. And it was a Mosley beam. I didn't know what it was, but I knew it went around on Saturday mornings around, you know. And so I followed the coax down to a window of another apartment on the first floor and knocked on the door. And Jim Walden, his call was W2IEY, but he was a ham radio operator. And he invited me in and showed me the wonderful world of ham radio and really saved my life, because I had nothing to do and I was scared and alone. So eventually I learned the Morse code. He gave me my novice and lost track of him for about 30, 40 years. And when the internet came along, I found him. And he was my Elmer. And he saved my life, and I was an 11-year-old kid, and I have met so many people through ham radio that I never would have met any other way. And it's been so wonderful of an enhancement for my life in general to be a ham. I owe him the world. And that's what we need more of in this day and age. When somebody's young and comes in and is interested in ham radio, you can do so much good to a kid. You can change his life forever for the better. And so that's my story. And Jim passed away about 3 years ago, but it was great after 30 years to connect with him again. And he came to a concert one time and had to use some earplugs, but he really enjoyed the show.
Oh, that's great, Joe. Great story. Well, I there's one other picture. It's kind of my favorite picture of you. I think you were in St. Louis. We were with you at that show. And it's my favorite picture of you on stage. That was really great, acknowledging all of the applause and greetings from the audience. But you've certainly have caused a lot of sensations, both in the music industry as well as ham radio, and we appreciate very much you being here. And I personally want to take one more minute because I have so many people ask me about this thing. And, you know, this thing has been kind of a fun thing for all of us. And it was you and Crinkle and I that came up with this deal after Rocky Mountain Way and figured out how to make the talk box. And you still use it almost every concert. Is that correct?
Sure. I have to.
You have to.
People are yelling for it. Yeah, it's a brilliant way to show true modulation. It's a great way to explain modulation. Maybe we'll do that sometime on one of the Ham Nation shows. But you get a piece of surgical tubing, and the sound of the guitar does not go through a speaker. The sound comes up the piece of surgical tubing, and you put the hose, the surgical tubing in your mouth, and you go. You talk, but you don't make any sound. And because the guitar coming up the surgical tubing provides the sound. So you don't use your larynx. You just talk like that. And what you have is the guitar talking. And we'll do that at one of the next shows.
That'll work. And of course, we had so much fun with that. There's quite a history with Pete Drake, and it goes back to, 1939 with Alvino Ray. And guess what? Alvino Ray, that really brought it to prominence, he was a ham, W6UH. I used to work him on 20 meters a lot. So ham radio's done a lot for each of us. And there's so many that our careers meant something to ham radio. And last but not least, you know, about 8 years ago, you said you need to do something with your microphone. And you helped me work on this little guy, which turned out to be a Goldline Pro, turned out to be a whole new division. And I really appreciate it publicly what you've done to help us with some of the designs and tell me, yeah, that sounds good, or no, that doesn't sound good. But there again, it's great, and it's just fun. Joe, are you still doing anything on the road when you travel? It's pretty tough, I know, because you guys are so busy. Do you do any operating from the hotels or where you are out on the tour?
You know, Bob, I did for a long time, but it's harder and harder. The hotels have all converted to sealed windows that you can't open. I guess that's the new fire code or something, but I used to be able to get a window open and at least hang a wire out. And the other thing is, we ride in a tour bus and used to use a Hustler antenna and mount it on the back of the bus, except every time we went through a toll booth, it'd take the antenna off. And so, you know, I left a trail of Hustler resonators across the country and just finally gave up. I do take 2 meters and try and check in now and then. That seems to work pretty good. But yeah. I kind of gave up taking a rig and all. It just works better to get on the air when I get home.
Sure. Well, we're going to go have George tell us a little bit about ICOM. And then we're going to come back with you. The chat room is just going crazy. And we'll bring Amanda in and let's answer some questions from the chat room as we close the show. But before that, let's go see what George has as a message from ICOM.
All right.
Get out and get mobile. Whether you're looking for a handheld, mobile, or HF rig, ICOM has a radio to get you operating on your next adventure. Take ICOM's IC7100 D-Star radio with you this season. An angled control head and touchscreen provide user-friendly operation. A large internal speaker delivers clear digital audio, and it's perfect for multi-band and all-mode communications. Interested in easy hands-free operation when you hit the road? ICOM's analog IC2730A mobile and the D-Star ID5100A both feature optional Bluetooth capability, a large backlit screen for high contrast viewing, and 50 watts output power on both VHF and UHF. Go far with ICOM's D-Star dual bander, the ID51A+. Check out the Near Me repeater function for D-Star as well as analog repeaters, free downloadable RSMS1A Android app, plus integrated GPS. Hit the trail with ICOM's IC7410. This HF rig is solid in performance and construction. High-grade DSP, all-mode operation, easy menu and ergonomic dials, and large heatsink for a heavy duty cycle operation. Make sure you visit ICOMAmerica.com/amateur for more information on ICOM's complete line of amateur radio products.
And you can tune in and enter to win. After each episode of Ham Nation, go to ICOMAmerica.com/hamnation. Throw your name in the hat for some great swag prizes like T-shirts or hats. And you can also find out how you could win in the monthly grand prize drawing. For June, the grand prize is going to be the IC2738 Practical Analog Dual Band Dual Watch Mobile with 50 watts of output power on both VHF and UHF, a large, easy-to-see display, optional Bluetooth headset, wideband receive, and much more. So go to ICOMAmerica.com/hamnation. After this and each episode of Ham Nation, throw your name in the hat. Who knows? You could be next month's lucky winner. Well, now let's bring in Amanda and see what's going on in the chat room this evening.
Well, good evening, everybody. And of course, the chat room is going crazy because Mr. Walsh is here. Thanks so much for being here, Joe.
I'm having a great time.
That's great. And I do have a lot of questions for you. The first one being, why don't you tell us about your most favorite project that you've worked on with Bob?
Oh, my goodness.
Too many to choose from?
Yeah, there's a lot of them. You know, taking an AM station to W1AW was really great. We had a couple different hams help with that. But we just really thought there should be an AM station there. And from Newington, you can work all of New England. And that was a really good feeling. That was a really good feeling because they're kind of contest oriented and they don't have a whole lot of modes, different modes to use. I guess the very pioneering days of getting Heil microphones from an idea, from a good idea to being a real thing, makes me feel like a great accomplishment too. Bob did most of the work, but I just thought with his knowledge and awareness and all that, especially when the static D-104s went out of business, hams just needed a better option of microphones rather than the mic that came with the rig when you bought it. And Bob was able to get a really good communications microphone up and running, and then of course expanded that to quality broadcast mics and recording mics and all kinds of and then contest headsets and all like that. So just being on board, riding shotgun with Bob as he got the company up and running, I think is a great accomplishment, and I hope it's helped a lot of hams, with options to get on the air, depending on what purpose they're gonna need a microphone for. How's that?
That's an awesome answer. Thank you so much, Joe. By the way, I'm just going to let my husband, K0JSC, slip in here and say hi real quick.
How are you doing?
No, wait, we have a microphone.
Hey, Joe, how you doing? Good to see you tonight.
I'm good. Hi. How are you?
Excellent. Excellent. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, Joe, for saying hi. Bob, what do you agree with Joe? Is that your most, funnest project that you've worked on with Joe?
Yeah, it's the only thing we can really talk about. we used to destroy things and burn things up and blow things up, but I'd fix them and then everybody's back on the air again. But we did a lot of damage on stages, but when we left the venues, they were okay with that. No, the microphone project over those few years that we worked together on that was really cool. So, good answer.
That's so funny. You guys let the smoke out of a lot of stuff there. So I'd love to hear more about that, by the way. Joe, well,
there's all of that stuff too. I used to go crazy on stage and break everything, and then Bob would have to glue it all back together and figure out how to make it work for the next evening. So he was busy. he was busy in hotels with a bunch of super glue, trying to get some of the equipment working again, but I didn't think that was appropriate for this kind of show.
Oh, that's funny, actually. I wish I could sit down with the two of you and hear a whole lot more stories about that. Joe, so again, I know you started out when you're, I think you said 12 years old. Do you have any most memorable contacts? Anything that you've worked that you're really, really proud of or that means a lot to you?
Yeah. One year, I worked a contest. A very good friend of mine is John Brosnahan, W0UN. And I've known John for years and years and years. He was around and helped me with a lot of equipment and stuff. But here's a brilliant ham. He lives in Texas now. But he was invited to the United Arab Emirates for a guy named Ali, AJ, A61AJ. A61AJ, I think, was his call. And he had a contest station, and we went and worked. And believe me, we were the object of a huge pileup. This was, I guess, the CQ DX contest, and we worked a bunch of bands, but we didn't have to change frequencies at all. A61AJ was a real multiplier for a lot of people, and just seeing that many guys really working the contest, trying to win it. I think we came in second or third, but that was a great experience to work a contest. If you've never really seriously tried to compete in a contest, I recommend it. There's nothing else like it.
Oh, I do agree, and it's that's rough business, though, I'll tell you. Just working the Ham Nation special event last week with all of the pileup, Bob, wouldn't you say that was pretty much like a contest if you were the DX station?
Those pileups were as big as anything that I've heard from this side. So yeah, it was a really fun event, a special event, and we'll have to do it again. Everybody is really looking forward to the next one. So thanks for being there, Amanda.
Thank you, and thank you, Joe, so much for joining us, and happy 200th, Ham Nation. So glad to be here. Oh, and just in case you guys wanted to know how I got on Ham Nation, this is a funny story. I didn't know who Bob Heil was. I guarantee that. And I got an email from Mr. Heil, and he said, me and Gordon West would love you to be on our show called Ham Nation. I said, I yelled out to Jeff. I said, Jeff, do you know who Bob Heil is? He says, yes, I do. I said, do you know who a Gordon West is? Yes, I do. I said, well, they want me on some weird show called Ham Nation. What do you think? And I did have to do CPR on him, by the way, you guys. Anyhow, I've learned so much more from this show after being on it. Thank you, Bob, so much for the opportunity, and love being on here for you guys every week. So back to you, Bob.
Well, you've been a great part of it, and we really appreciate it. Joe, thanks a lot for spending time with us tonight. I know that that you're going to be out again Sunday. You're off into where? Nashville, is it Sunday?
Yes, for about 3 days, and then I come back for about 10 days, and then we're out for, I think, 14 more Eagle shows.
All right. Are you on the air at all these days when you do get back home, and is most of it AM, or are you doing some sideband work? Where can people maybe find you?
Probably try 20 meters. Probably try 20 meters, but I tell you what, right now the sunspots aren't very ham friendly. That's for sure. I'll get on sideband. Probably 20 meters. I'm an old 20 meters fan. Get on there in the afternoon and maybe look at the Collins net. 14.263, I think, on Sunday, and stuff like that. So if I'm going to be anywhere, I'll be on a 20 meter sideband.
Okay. Well, we will look for you and, of course, find you on the AM somewhere. And hopefully we can get back on, and we'll have to play with that talk box thing. That sounds interesting, and bring some acoustic science to amateur radio. That's basically what it is. Well, this has been great. How could we top a 200th show and have everybody here? It would be really great if everybody could be here, but we just don't have enough machines out in Petaluma. And Brian, you've been great through all of this, all 200 shows. You haven't been here all 200, but boy, you've been here for the majority. We appreciate all of what you do back at the studio to keep it all together. And I personally have to thank Exceed. None of this would happen for me if it wasn't for Exceed, because I'm out in the country. When I moved to this location, I have no internet and I have no cell phone. And I said, no problem. 2 weeks later, Exceed fired up, and here we are. And it's just been wonderful, because usually satellite communication does not work very well. And as you can see, it works extremely well from Exceed. And I put up my own cell phone repeater, so Sarah has a cell phone working, and we're all happy here in the Ozarks. So 7-3, everybody. We will look for you next week here. Joe, we'll catch you on the road somewhere. Stay in touch, everybody. And the main thing is, get on the air. Let's talk ham radio. Bye-bye for now. This is K9EID.